I brought a, you know, what in the photography business we call a book dummy digitally to show you a spread that I'm working on this work. And then, you know, I'll tell you a little bit about what's going on here. Just to give you a little bit of background about the work, it deals with a couple of questions, and there are a couple of different kinds of processes represented. But basically, it started with, I was thinking, I was actually in a residency at Yaddo in Saratoga Springs working on another project along the Hudson River, and which is a black and white project that I'd been working on for a long time, and it's almost done but not quite done, and it's also something I'm working on as a book. But I'd been, I was at this residency, and it's a very kind of esteemed place, and there are, you know, like Susan Orlean was there when I was there. All kinds of writers are, you know, working on their manuscripts, and composers, you know, composing on the piano, and I have a dark room there, and which is really lovely. If anyone wants to, any photographers would like to visit there sometime. But you know, the darkroom is the studio place for the photographer traditionally, and then of course you know, in the digital context, the computer is a studio for the photographer. But the one very different thing about a photographer conventionally is that a photographer goes out into the world. So, you know, if you stroll the grounds of Yaddo, you know, in the afternoon, like you might, you know, go past a residence and you'll hear the composer on the piano, or you'll glimpse the choreographer, thinking of a dance. But or you see the writer, you know, typing. I was there in the summer, typing on the laptop in on a bench. But for me, I found that, you know, my project, I was there because I wanted access to that stretch of the Hudson River that was near there. And so every day, you know, I had a quick breakfast and ran out and basically wandered and had experiences in the world. You know, it's how a photographer works. There's a kind of peripatetic quality to the photographer. One goes out, one meets people, you know, their serendipity, encounters, they lead to portraits, landscape photographs. And so I'd been working in this kind of tradition of photography, a documentary, you know, it's called documentary tradition, although it's not exactly that one is making documents, photographing out in the world. And my background is that I used to be, among many various hats that I've worn, one is that I used to be a photojournalist, and I worked in zones of conflict. It's kind of hard, or a little hard for me to imagine now because I have a small kid and I'm, you know, so domestic, but I used to, you know, be based, and one as a photojournalist, one never lives somewhere where one is always based, like you're based in Baku and Moscow, or you're based in Amman, Jordan, and New York. So I was based in various places and was essentially a freelancer, although I worked also through an agency out of London. But I traveled around the world for a good 6 years photographing on assignment in war zones. You know, like my first experience was going to Kosovo in 1999, and, you know, starting in Macedonia, entering Kosovo, entering Pristina with the KFOR forces that were liberating Kosovo, and then I worked in Afghanistan, and I worked in around the Palestinian conflict, and I worked in Iraq, Pakistan, then in Moscow around you know, the former Soviet Union and Central Asia, and was based in Baku, briefly worked in Iran, you know, et cetera. So this was my life, but it was something that I did from a rather naive point of view as a photographer, because it was so much about, you know, the question of what one's work was about was so much about where one was, like, what story are you covering? And the story was so much about, you know, about a place. And all those kinds of, you know, struggles for independence and other things about crumbling empires. And at some point through it, I started to think about what the stories had in common and the kind of typology of the photojournalistic story. And the symbols that one used, you know, there was always a lady in a headscarf, there was always crying, there was always, you know, someone weeping over, you know, someone who has gone too soon, or signs of protest, and all these things, and the kinds of broad strokes that were asked of me, such as, you know, in Russia, I realized I'm originally from Russia, but in Russia I was working for the New York Times, and I realized that I was always being asked to see Russia according to broad types. You know, so there was the kind of impoverished old lady and the kind of lavish, ostentatious, well-to-do, you know, person. And that was something that made me rethink photography, my approach to photography, and my approach to, you know, being a working, you know, working as an editorial photographer. And I ended up back at Columbia, where I had previously studied Italian literature, and then I went back to Columbia and got my MFA in art, and, you know, with a concentration in photography. But so, but my practice came out of the fact that I always wanted to be in the world, and that, you know, I do on some fundamental level see photography as a medium that allows you to put your body in a place, the way that, you know, a dancer puts one, you know, it's a kind of classic trope of how we talk about photography, that photography is like dance. You know, you move your body in space. The camera, of course, sometimes the camera is a metaphor for the body, and you go, you move it, and that movement in relationship to the movement of the world results in the photographs. And so one thing that I had been thinking about was, as a coming out of the MFA program. So, you know, this talk, even though there are just a couple of students in the audience, the talk is geared at students. You know, how you think about, you know, how you come to work. That I had gone to an interdisciplinary art program as a graduate student, and, you know, surrounded by artists of all kinds of mediums, and I was interested how much the studio was an important place. You know, this notion of, you know, one makes work in a privileged space and has this heightened experience, and the studio almost becomes a subject matter. There's a show actually up now I hope I can get to see at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. There's a new curator of photography from France, and his first show is about the role of the studio in photography. So I was thinking about the studio and the fact that I was always going out, and I thought, is there a way that I could take, so this is basically what all this work is born out of, that is there a way that I could take the conceit of the studio, but maybe not just the conceit, but the whole hands-on process and opportunity of working in the studio, but then say that it's not that I'm bringing the world into the studio, it's that the studio is going out into the world. Like, I am the studio, you know, when I travel, that whole notion of engaging with materials and with a process travels with me. And so it's something that began with that picture over there. with the apples, the green apples against the backdrop. And I actually have it, you know, I'll show you in my book dummy, I'll cut through, you know, at the point. So this is a work in progress that I'm trying to think through how to sequence the work and even, you know, how to edit the work, what, you know, what the limits of the work are. But I, you know, it began with this thing of why don't I look at horticulture and the motifs of horticulture as a kind of metaphor for life, and you know, the with all the kinds of complexity of what is natural and what is cultivated, and then think about, you know, the studio materials and this and separating it and being in the field with it. So the work that you're seeing here is mixed in. It's not, you know, chronological. It's all the different kinds of permutations of what this process has been. But it began with horticulture, and then at a certain point, there's something one talks about in photography too, about, you know, it comes from John Tarkovsky, and Todd Papageorge, you know, wrote about. Gary Winogrand, as you know, who's a famous American street photographer of the 1970s, that he photographed things that move. You know, that it's really, again, you know, the relationship to dance. That you know, so I was thinking that as I was going through what, you know, what can one do with the environment, it occurred to me that really the tropes that that would be interesting to explore would be you know, creating a drawing of a bird as a photograph. And I had this image in my mind. It's actually not in the show. It's that photograph there on the left. But I had this kind of image that I would get access to birds, and I would create have a backdrop, and they would fly across it as they were released, and I would freeze them and photograph them. And so this is a chipping sparrow. This is an I went out with a professor. This was actually the first time I had access to birds. On the left, I went out with a professor from Hunter College, from the psychology department, whose area of study is, you know, birds who lay eggs that look very similar to other eggs, and they camouflage. So basically, they end up being adopted by other birds, and then the ones who lay them get to go out and do other things. And so he was taking students to a demonstration in the Hudson Valley. So for those of you who are not familiar with it, it's called banding. So you set up mist nets, well, that are called mist nets. They're essentially kind of like a large volleyball net, but they have several layers of pockets, and they're made of a very thin black vinyl, and the birds fly into them and get confused. And you know, some birds are good at evading them, like blue jays, I've learned, you know, never get caught. And they're like, gee, I see you, mist net, and I'm gonna go right around you. But many birds get caught in them, and then they can't break free. And then the people who do the banding are on a schedule where, okay, time to go check the nets, you know, every 15 minutes to every hour, it varies. And then they check them, and then they disentangle the birds, and then they measure them, sex them. I learned about sexual dimorphism when, you know, the male and the female look different. They check their age, you know, and then they record all that data. They give them a bracelet, and they let them go. So the way that I've worked with birds has been a collaboration, essentially, although I don't know how fruitful it is for the collaborating part, you know, kind of like I get the pictures, although, you know, they've been incredibly, all the different kinds of organizations I've worked with have been incredibly supportive, but my imagined ability to freeze motion. I was almost thinking of Moy Bridge, you know, kind of like the horses galloping in front of the backdrop and, you know, motion studies. And of course it didn't work at all because it was just, the birds were released and they were gone. You know, by the time I was there with the cable, we're like, where did it go? It's gone. You know, and it was actually very exciting that it happened so fast. But I've had to come up with a whole bag of tricks for how to deal with this problem if I wanted to use backdrops and have this kind of studio environment in the field. So all the pictures that you're seeing, you know, and I'll take you through, I guess I can go back to the beginning and show you, you know, you'll see some others that aren't in the show, but all of these pictures, are made in the field, essentially. Although the field also includes a couple of psychology studios where there are captive birds that are used in experiments. But basically my husband, who was helping me with on that first day, came up with a device of, oh, what if there's a hole and you can hold the legs of the bird through the hole, and then the bird could be on top, and it can look it could look like it's in flight, but actually it's not. So the hole became this kind of metaphor for thinking about the accent, almost if you think about the two-dimensional art object as the the relationship of the role of the picture plane and what's in front of the picture plane, what's behind the picture plane. Of course, the picture plane is flat, but it has this sense of illusion that you're looking into the picture and there's a perceived psychological depth. And so, mostly what I've done is to eliminate that depth, but the hole is this kind of, at times revealing it, I think of as a kind of metaphor for what's behind the picture plane. And then I've done since then various kinds of things. One of the places I've worked quite a lot as in this picture is, and that red one, the one with the red backdrop over there, the one with the, I'll talk about the light leaks on the one on the left, is and the one with the Piero della Francesca backdrop over there are, and the one with the berries, the second one. So a bunch of these, and the yellow one, were at a place called Manomet in on the eastern shore of Massachusetts, about an hour south of Boston. It's actually south of Plymouth. There's a peninsula and there's an amazing research facility and that's existed since the 1970s. Some family bequeathed it to research and naturalism and preservation. And it's the kind of thing, it's like the most amazing bluff, the most amazing property. And it's wonderful that people, it's actually like very community driven. People have access to it. People come out and help band, learned how to band, help band, school groups come through, school children get to release, learn about birds and release them. And they've given me really great access. So I've spent a bunch of days there where I come with all my, it's kind of ridiculous, like unloading the car. It takes like six trips to the car to get everything. So I'm using, with the birds, I'm using strobes. So I'm freezing motion with the flash, and I have various kinds of backdrops. I've used the so-called photo studio, which is almost, I feel like, is a cruel joke because it's a the photo studio as prison, like a kind of system where the bird can't leave, and of course many of the clever ones do leave quickly, as I've tried to envision it in flight. And this one here is on the right, is kind of one of the signature images from the project, but where I'm thinking of the way, ways of dealing with that illusionistic space and allowing depth and having the absence of depth. And then I'm also thinking about, like, as in the one with the hawk over there, where there's a wrinkled backdrop, that one is, that kind of what happens when you try to impose this order on the situation, and there's a form of excess in terms of, you know, the thing, the life of the thing is more, you know, kind of greater than your desire to impose order on it. There's actually one of the little tiny details in that picture that I quite like, is there's a teeny tiny stain of blood from the mouse that had been tossed on the backdrop for this hawk, you know, because this is in Pleasantville at the Pace University campus in Pleasantville, where they have a nature laboratory, you know, so they take the hawks out for daily flights. And you know, and the guy who runs it worked with me there. So I've gone through this whole process, and I've also thought about, you know, ways of, you know, so it's kind of been back and forth where I work with birds for a while. I do things with the, you know, go back to the landscape, you know, so I've also done landscape stuff more recently, but I've essentially been thinking about tropes of representing nature in the 19th century and notions of positivism, and you know, and obviously the obvious reference here is John James Audubon. And I had actually, you know, one of the ideas that I came back to when I started the project was that I had photographed a contemporary artist for a New Yorker portrait that I had to do, named Walton Ford. I don't know if any of you know his work, but he actually lives in Great Barrington and keeps his studio, and I keep meaning to get in touch. I haven't seen him in like 5 years now, but he had, when I did the portrait of him, you know, he told me, I wasn't very familiar with, you know, besides like knowing the imagery of Audubon's work, but he explained to me, you know, he's a drawer and painter, explained to me the use of the grid and the pinning of that, you know, so Audubon killed all his birds, all his specimens, pinned them to a grid, and in very, you know, what were supposed to be naturalistic ways, but actually weren't. You know, it's kind of obvious to the contemporary viewer that, you know, these things are twisted in a, you know, kind of strange way. But it was all because how he was able to pin them, and then he was able to draw, you know, to render them accurately, and then include, you know, the make it seem as though it were actually in flight in the landscape. And yeah, so I had learned about this, and you know, had been thinking about the relationship to drawing, and that's another part, a thing of what this work is about, is you know, thinking about drawing, like you know, it's something, I'm obviously also a photography educator, and that's something one talks to students about a lot, is, you know, what is illustration, and what is photography's relationship to illustration, and you know, that one of the truisms is that photography is a poor means of illustration, that, you know, like if you were reading traditionally, looking at, say, you know, a biology textbook, there wouldn't be photographs. If you had to explain how molecules work, you would draw them, you know, so to highlight the differences, the same way that maps are drawn rather than being, you know, aerial photographs, because drawings are more schematic, but then the photograph, you know, has its own kind of logic about what the camera sees. And I was thinking about what is, you know, what happens when you kind of cross-pollinate the logic of the drawing and the logic of the camera. So then I've done various things where I started to really think about the surface of the print and ways of playing with that, and the kinds of effect, the history of, you know, of teasing the surface, or teasing out the surface in photography and in visual art, so that, you know, that image there with the red in it, I came to something where I was saw the possibility of recreating a Harry Callahan photograph, but then I was also thinking of the Malevich red square and playing with what's at the what is the backdrop, what is the surface, what is the how does one even have abstraction in photography when abstraction is this kind of the pure materiality, but that you're turning your camera at things in the world. And one of the things that I started to do, so there are just three photographs in this exhibit have light leaks, deliberate light leaks on the film. So where, in the dark room before I went out to photograph, I exposed, I was thinking about all kinds of the constructivist shapes and what one can do with very simple masks, and I exposed them to light. And then there was this element of chance that I had the kind of flawed, leaked film, and then I used it to photograph. So actually, in my sequencing of the book, one of the things that I'm thinking about, like where in the early part of it, I'm using the landscape and the idea of depth in the image. And then and then the flattened space of the paper. But the one on the left here is from the Columbia University psychology lab. Those are finches, various types of finches that they use for experiments. And I had created this kind of perverse space where because birds always want to perch, and I always think that when people really know this work, they'll know that I'm a terrible person because of all the kinds of perverse things that are in here. But I actually have been very more, let's say, you don't want to know what they do at Columbia to these birds. But I birds want to perch, and then I put it at an angle so they kept sliding down, and then but they always want to perch a little bit higher than the next guy, and coming back through, and that one on the right was an amazing woodpecker I wasn't prepared for in the Hudson Valley, but in sequencing the book, I have these kinds of more flattened ones in the first part, and then as I get into the second part, you have this kind of falling apart of the surface, the more you might say the surface effects. So that's how I'm thinking about it now. I'm not quite sure if it'll work, but it actually the surface experimentation started with that I had a mistake where I exposed some of the I had the when one's loading film. So this is all shot with a 4x5-inch camera. So I'm using sheet film. I'm loading the sheets in a dark room, and I was loading the film, and one has a tendency in the dark room to close one's eyes when working, and then at a certain point I opened them and realized that the safe light had been on, and they'd all been exposed to red, and then I decided to save them, squirrel them away, and use them. So I think this one had been exposed to light maybe 2 years earlier than that, and then I had saved it and I shot it, and then I started thinking about doing it deliberately. So it's a little hard to see the purple in the background there, but I thought that with the second part, the sense of wanting to break the fourth wall would be something that I would play with more. In these couple of pictures, there are things inside the camera that are masking, part of what I'm photographing goes into the camera, and then there are more of these with the light leaks and the surface treatment. So essentially, the ones with the light leaks, with the birds are pretty much the most recent thing that I've done with this. Oh, this one on the left, there's a leaf, the leaf is inside the camera while I'm taking a picture of this kind of landscape. But and then just the other kind of a part of this work that I haven't talked about yet is that the work that's on that wall that I've been kind of back and forth about whether it is, I think I'm curious to hear your thoughts too. I think it makes sense in an exhibition, and I'm thinking that for the book, I'm going to keep it separately and develop it, you know, develop it more as an ongoing project. But it, what started happening was the two that are on the left, especially the first one on the left on that wall, was I'd been thinking about, you know, putting paper, I've been putting paper in the landscape and photographing the landscape with paper and with art materials. And I thought that, you know, how can I make the landscape itself, you know, a receptacle of the image. And I did various kinds of things. I tried to enter this kind of experimental phase with photograms in the landscape and pinhole cameras in the landscape. And part of it that happened, of course, is I had a child and I was taking walks all the time with, and all I could do was bring these cameras that could kind of passively sit and receive an image. And so I started doing that. And then it occurred to me the two images and the rest of the four images are that, something that I became interested in relating to photojournalism and relating to bird migration was the idea of sending the camera where I cannot go. You know, maybe almost like thinking, what if the bird is a sort of camera? Like, what if the camera were to go on its own travel without me? And, as part of course, is, not being a photojournalist anymore, you know, my access to the world is quite limited. And so I devised a system of putting pinhole cameras in the mail. And so the exposures are, the pinhole looks up, and the address label is on top, which ensures that the pinhole camera look up. And then the cameras are traveling and making these exposures. So the ones in the middle there are 11 by 14. That's the actual, and they're negative, and that's the actual paper that that is going through the mail in a box that's big. And then the two color ones are sheet film, 4x5-inch sheet film. And in the most recent incarnation for this show, I was interested in the possibility of, like, I got to scan the whole film, and there are photo corners, basically. I don't know if you see the vignetting that, I'm loading them into these little film boxes, and the little film boxes become the parcels, and then those are the exposure. So wherever you see the kinds of streaky light, that is where it caught the sun for a minute, and as it moved around, it made a kind of drawing, and then you see kind of like its point of view being in the mail basket. And then the ones on the right, I re-photographed with paper negatives, one of the other pictures that's in this show. So maybe I'll say leave it there and take questions. Yes? The ones that traveled farther, such as my brother in Hawaii, did not work out. These mostly, basically what I've been doing, what I realized the only thing that has worked is to send them to myself, which is kind of a cruel irony because of course I want to travel, but where can I go? It can just do a loop down to Hartford, and then come back first to my home address, and then to a P.O. box after the Northampton postmaster put a kibosh on the project. And then when I was teaching in New York last summer, then I was sending them from New York. So it's like whenever I go somewhere, I send one to myself, but they're essentially like sending them to friends almost, or family almost entirely hasn't worked out. Like, it's too much trouble to then say, I mean, in theory, it would be like, I'll send it to you, send it to me, and it'll have some transformation as a result of that, but it hasn't worked. You know, I haven't thought through how to make it work. Or how to, you know, put the logic of that transaction into the process. So they've just traveled, you know, most of them have just traveled to me.
I just wondered how long they were supposed, like, I don't...
Yeah, like a couple of days. I mean, the funny thing is, you know, if in the photography, there's something called reciprocity failure. Like, if it sees light enough, the light ceases to have an effect. And you know, so it, like, where it sees the fluorescent lights, you know, for a long time, it doesn't overexpose. Of course, with the paper, I'm restraining developing a little bit. Like, I have very, very diluted, I mean, this is shop talk, very diluted Edwall TST developer with a lot of Part B, where it's like really restrained highlights, which are, you know, very restrained blacks. And with the color, I don't have that kind of control, which is why many of them are blown out, or like the exposures are all over the place. But some of, you know, a lot of them do work.
Oh yeah.
Well, of course, because the paper has a very low ISO and the film has a very high ISO, so then I use neutral density filters on the film. I like the way, so it's somewhat, I'm a little on the fence, you know, with the large ones conceptually, because it's not the thing itself. The way that the small ones are the thing itself that did the journey. The large ones, then you print in a conventional way, you know, so I'm scanning them, removing the dust. So I kind of want it to be the thing itself more, so I'm not sure how to continue with the color, you know, or the logic of having color and black and white in the project, but it's something that, you know, I'm kind of trying to figure out.
Yes?
Do you make the pinhole camera with the box that you send, or do you have a pinhole camera that you actually
make? No, they're all crude boxes, because the point is to make them look like packages. And another thing, of course, is, like, you know, having had the baby, oh, there's tons of boxes from diapers.com. You know, those are
each
the
box is its own camera.
Yeah, and then I can reuse them once they come back to me. My favorite box was seized and destroyed by the postmaster of Northampton, because of surveillance, like the fact that I'm penetrating their system.
How did he find out?
I naively, the first day I came in, I had the address label facing down, and then I was like, wait a minute, I was like, I needed to face up. Of course, like, everyone's like, oh, you're the crazy lady, you know, when you go to the post office, because there are so many battles, like when they want to put tape over the pinhole, and you're like, no, don't tape it there, and they're like, excuse me, and I said, let me retape it, and they're like, whoa. So the first time I came in, I was like, I needed to be this way, and then suddenly I was like, duh, I shouldn't have said anything, you know. So then, it's a big hassle. And you know, the thing that I like that happens is when it actually sees the landscape, not just the post office lights, like that one on the left in the middle, you know, it sees trees, but that you only get that when you send to a residential address. So I can no longer send to my residential address, so I have a post office box in another town.
Well, I wonder if you could send a package to someone with the hole covered up and then have that person rip off.
Right, you can have people make pinhole exposures on their own, right? You could send them to, you know, prisoners in Guantanamo, or, you know, whatever. Like there are things conceptually you could do, but can you actually do them, and what would you actually get? Yeah, so I mean, that's the question that I have to work out. Maybe send them, yeah.
How do you take pictures of birds and not have them be blurry? I'm not a photographer, yeah. So I'm really amazed at that cardinal and how
still. The cardinal, well, partly they do stay, so they do get subdued. I mean, I have other pictures where, let's see, one of the, I mean, just to show you, sometimes I want, because it's always this kind of thing, you're like, you want them to move, like this one is in flight. But there's a strobe, and the strobe freezes. So a strobe is a flash, and it has a short duration. So it provides the light, and it's a fraction of a second. And that's one of the things that if you really geek out, you think, like, how do I make that duration even shorter? You know, like if you ever see, like, I don't know if it's like American Express or who uses the ads where like there are dancers and you see, if you see their toes are very sharp and the tips of their fingers, like the things that move the fastest are very sharp, it's because they have a very short duration for the flash and the flash freezes the motion. But then when you have something where the background and the foreground, you know, like the natural light is combined with the strobe light, so like, yeah, in this cardinal, then you, you know, basically, you can't have as much depth of field, which is why the background is a little bit blurry, and you need a lot of light to balance with the background, and then the truth is it's not moving that much at that point, it's quite subdued, but I've, you know, had others where I was interested to see, oh, actually, I'll show you the back cover one, I was interested to see, you know, I've done a lot, too, with, what happens when they move and what blur looks like. So this is the one that I have currently for the back cover, where it's like, I'm like, okay, fly away, you know, because mostly they know that that they're subdued and they just wait. And then the second, you know, you loosen the grip, they're gone. But that to get them to flutter and to see what the fluttering looks like. Yes?
Yeah, I know you talk a lot about it, but this idea between the illustration and the abstraction, and just like looking at a picture like that, when birds ring, so it starts to create this sort of triangular shape, then you start to create with the light fogging the paper, the film. Or is that leading to that, like you thought of, or even just like the linear shape to use in the ones that what I would call more illustrative, which, you know, that you have these hard lines often, but then you start to mimic by.
Ah, that's interesting. I hadn't thought about, I mean, the fact that my shapes are so primitive has to do with partly it's what I'm able to do. Like, I haven't used a laser cutter to cut the masks or to try to do really interesting things at the level of shape. I was interested, almost maybe, you know, like one of the stupid, okay, this is a fictional publisher, by the way, Jiga Vertov Press, but I thought, what if I use some of the motifs of Russian constructivism? So to think of this kind of, I guess it's like I'm kind of trying to cross-pollinate so many movements in art history where I'm thinking of the earlier 19th century, but then I'm also thinking of these early utopian impulses and like Laszlo Moholy Nagy. And so I was thinking of very crude shapes that you get, you know, the fact that it's that the film is two-dimensional, and I'm actually using the little rectangles that come in the film box, and like, what can you do to it? You bisect it, you know, and it's like that one on the left there, it's similar to so many flags, but it comes out of this basic thing, like what can you do to a rectangle? You know, you cut it like this, you cut it like that, and then you move them around. So I liked that, like that kind of reference that's in there. So, you know, all in my book layout, all my fictional essay writers all have the initials of Russian constructivists. but that's, you know, that is a separate thing here. But that's where the kind of, you know, like I guess where more like where this work is going, thinking about those shapes in relationship to the history of a kind of political utopianism. Yes?
When you did that exposure on films, did you have conscious of how you expose it?
Neutral density filter on the flashlight. colored gels. I mean, yeah, you know, you try, but there's this kind of, I mean, I think in photography, the, you know, one thing that's great is this kind of meeting between your effort and chance. So there's obviously some trial and error when I use, like the first one, and I have it in the spread some here, was, you know, way too exposed. And, oh, this one was very exposed, and I had to, you know, darken it quite a bit, and then I realized how much. But then there's still that correspondence between what you try to do and what happens and when it works and how it lines up with the things that are in the picture. I mean, there's a whole school of people now doing work that are just that kind of studio-based exposure. There's a woman, I think Jessica Eaton is her name, who fabricates shapes where she exposes, I think she has like a white cube and she shines different colored lights on it and it looks like, you know, things like where the different colors cross, you know, that real kind of like art foundations, what happens when you cross different colors. But it was interesting to me that, what you know, whatever I did that I controlled in the studio would have some kind of ramification when you go out into the world. All right, thank you guys.